back to How We Keep the Art Alive. This is a segment produced by Tenacious Theatrics, where we celebrate the artists who are working very hard and persevering through this really incredible time during this pandemic, during this tragedy, is what I like to call it. But yeah, we're here to talk to three amazing artists tonight, several who I've worked with, and one, again, who I'm excited to get to know even better tonight. My name is Leonard W. Rose. I am the founder and artistic director for Tenacious Theatrics, and we're going to go ahead and get started with my good friend, Wylie Gavin Lyall.
Hey!
It's the three names I have to remember what order they come into.
Wylie Gavin Lyall.
How are you, good sir?
I am doing well. How are you? How are you?
I'm fantastic. I am fantastic, glad that we have this opportunity to talk again. If you don't know, Gavin was our Frankenfurter in our Rocky Horror Online Cabaret that debuted back in October, which again was Tenacious Theatrics' first production. Tell me a little bit about that whole process for you and what that was like.
Oh man, it was fun, first and foremost. I had an absolute blast. Frank is a character that I've wanted to play for years. I have been a humongous fan of Rocky Horror since I was probably in the seventh grade, when I was on YouTube and I heard Sweet Transvestite for the first time, and the little gay boy in me just like lost his mind and was like, oh, this is exactly like, this is incredible, and Tim Curry's fantastic. So getting to do that was a really, really amazing like opportunity. I never thought that I would play Frankenfurter in the first place, simply because, you know, of typecasting. So I always thought, oh, I'll be pigeonholed into, you know, maybe a Brad, or maybe like the Meatloaf character, the Eddie. And getting to play Frank was like a shock first and foremost, but also like such an exciting process. And it was difficult, obviously, because we were filming it and recording it, and then we were submitting it, and we were trying to get the lighting right, and it was a do-it-yourself makeup situation, do-it-yourself costuming situation, and it was fun, it was fantastic, it was a learning experience. But I will say, having like already started the process of like the self-tape world, especially whenever COVID first started, and having to submit self-tapes for class, for productions, things of that nature, I was a little more accustomed to it, so it wasn't crazy out of my comfort zone. But it was fantastic. It was weird having never met the cast ever, not knowing like anybody in the cast except for like one person who I went to school with. But it was a blast, and I absolutely loved it.
Going off of what you said about like being typecast, I think that's one of Tenacious Theatrics' missions, is to not cast these people who would typically play these characters. Of course, there is a vision of the show, and you know, characters have to meet certain qualifications, but it should never be, no, I can't cast you because of this reason. Like, that you don't look like Frankenfurter, you don't sound exactly like Frankenfurter. You know, you played such a unique Frankenfurter, one that I'd never seen before, and I'm certain that our audience had never seen before. And everyone loved it. Just nonstop compliments about, wow, that guy's great. That guy's going places. And you're what, 20 now?
Oh no, I'm 23.
Oh, what happened? No, that's right, because you were still in school though when
I was still in school at the time. I have since taken a break from school, just to kind of focus more so on financial stability in these trying times. And yeah, I was in school, and then I wasn't in school, and yeah, but I am a nice spry 23 years of age. So
can you tell our audience just a little bit about where your background is and where you're from and all that stuff?
Yeah, certainly. I was born and raised in a very musical family in the Metro Jackson area of Mississippi. My parents both met when they were in college as music majors. They were actually like dueling piano vocalists, so like they would do this competition called Nats, and they would compete against each other in Nats, and they would compete against each other in Bach Fest, which is a piano festival, and my dad would win piano, and my mom would win voice, and then my dad would win voice, and my mom would win piano, and they would go back and forth and back and forth. And my mom hated my dad because he never, like, had to practice. And my dad hated my mom because my mom always practiced. So obviously they met each other and then got married and had children and then made us all, you know, pursue music to some extent. They didn't make us, but they were very much so adamant that if we had musical ability, we were going to have to foster said musical ability. So we did that. I was raised and classically trained by my mom and my dad, vocally. I was in choir, I was in show choir, I was in theater productions, I was a huge attender of Show Choir Camps of America, and through that I kind of found my like niche of musical theater. And I hadn't really done musical theater before I was actually like 13 or 14 years old. And I knew of it, but I had never really done it before. And as I progressed through high school, I was really interested in it. I thought it was fantastic. And I loved to act and I loved to sing first and foremost, and I loved to dance. I had been dancing in show choir and outside of show choir since I was like 11, but I had never found like a world where they all meshed other than show choir. And musical theater is what show choir is like birthed from. So I started getting into that more and more, and then I auditioned for Marymount Manhattan College over on the Upper East Side of Manhattan, which is that direction. And I was really lucky to get into the program and started going my freshman year, and then started auditioning for, you know, productions, and just started, you know, getting into musicals. And yeah, and from there I just kind of have ventured into that direction. I also grew up in a songwriting household. So I'm a songwriter as well. So I've been writing music really for reals since I was like 19 or 20. Started writing music. My dad is, you know, a composer. My great uncle has written some pretty like jazzin' tunes, like, you know, Mona Lisa. He wrote Silver Bells, the Christmas song Silver Bells. And I was like, so songwriting is in my blood and I love to do that as well. So I sing, I dance, I act, I write music, when I can. And yeah, and I live in New York. I live up in Harlem. And yeah, and I'm just living my best life while the world is put on pause at the moment. So yeah.
So once, I guess Rocky was done, because I know what you've done since the pandemic started, but once Rocky was done, what have the last couple months looked like for you?
They have been a little more like personal oriented. After I got done with Rocky, I kind of focused inwards and started trying to write a little bit more music. I actually started getting into playwriting a little bit, and started trying to write plays and play productions, and like screenplays, and just started writing a lot more, and just trying to enjoy that a little bit more. I've auditioned for a few productions here and there, unsuccessfully, sigh, but honestly I've just kind of been working and doing that. And it's weird, it's a difficult thing to not discuss necessarily, but a difficult thing to process, because we're doing theater, and or we're supposed to be doing theater, but we're not really able to, simply because of the state of the world around us. So it feels as though you're not doing anything. And you kind of feel bad about it, but then you kind of realize that, I mean, there are people dying all around us, and there are crazy things happening in the world. And my mentality is I'm going to use art as a way to bring myself joy. It is also my career field, but first and foremost, it's always been my first love. So in the meantime, whenever the world is kind of put on pause and, you know, you have these awesome opportunities like doing Rocky Horror with Tenacious, and things of that nature, I'm trying to kind of make sure I keep myself measured, Because as much as I want to just try to go and go and go and go and go, and I do, I know that there's a part of me that also needs to say, okay, let's pump the brakes. Let's sing because we like to sing today. Let's write music because we like to write music. Let's not do it because we feel this obligation to, you know, to just make sure that you're doing something. And it is, we gotta keep ourselves alive, because we are living, breathing artists and beings, and our job is to bring joy to ourselves and others. But we don't have to be so hard on ourselves. And so I'm trying not to be as hard on myself. And yeah, so still trying to practice and make sure that, you know, those skills are sharp for whenever Broadway opens her lovely doors back up, and I'm happy to like run straight through like a maniac.
Well, speaking of singing, you have something prepared for us tonight. I'm very excited to hear. What is it? Tell us all about it.
I am just going to be singing one of my favorite songs, which is Walking in Memphis by Mark Cohen. It's my go-to audition song, and it just brings me a lot of joy, and I hope that it can maybe bring everybody else some joy as well.
Absolutely. Go. Do it. Do it. Do it.
Put on my blue suede shoes and I boarded the plane. I touched down in the land of the Delta Blues in the middle of a pouring rain. WC handy, oh, she looked down over me. Yeah, I got a first class ticket, but I'm as blue as a boy can be. Then I'm walking in Memphis. I was walking with my feet 10 feet off a beam, walking in Memphis. But do I really feel the way I feel? I saw the ghost of Elvis on Union Avenue, followed him up to the gates of Graceland, and I watched him walk right through. Now security, they did not see him. They just hovered around his tomb. But there's a pretty little thing that's waiting for the king down in the jungle room. When I was walking in Memphis, I was walking with my feet 10 feet off a beam. Walking in Memphis. But do I really feel the way I feel? They've got catfish on the table. They've got gospel in the air. Oh, and Reverend Green, be glad to see you if you haven't got a prayer. But you've got a prayer down in Memphis. And a Muriel plays piano every Friday up in Hollywood. So they brought me down to see her, and they asked me if I would, well, do a little number. So I sang with all my might. Then she asked, tell me, are you a Christian child? And I said, ma'am, I am tonight, walking in Memphis. I was walking with my feet 10 feet off a beam, walking in Memphis. Oh, but do I really feel the way I feel walking in Memphis? I was walking with my feet 10 feet off a beam, walking in Memphis. But do I really feel the way I feel? Oh. Put on my blue suede shoes and I boarded the plane. touchdown in the land of the Delta Blues, in the middle of a pouring rain. Touchdown in the land of the Delta Blues, in the middle of a pouring rain. Ooh, ooh, yeah.
Absolutely incredible.
Thank you.
You are so good at telling the story.
Thank you.
I don't know if anyone else was tearing up during that, but I was certainly tearing up during that. You spread... Oh, there it goes again. I'll tell you, when you're talking about, you know, spreading joy with your singing in theater, everyone else on the call right now was just biggest grins I've ever seen. And Claire's also here watching, and she's got this, she's so incredible listening to you sing, Gavin. I'm so thankful to have met you and worked with you, and hopefully in the future we can work again.
Absolutely.
Once the Broadway opens back up, maybe, you know, fly back up and visit you guys and see you. Gavin, thank you so much for talking to us tonight.
Thank you.
Excellent. I love you, and we will see you soon.
Thank you. Thank you guys so much. I love you all. I love Tenacious. Support Tenacious Theatrics, please. They are fantastic. They are doing amazing work, and they are run by people who care about keeping art alive. And I know it sounds cheesy, but that's what matters, and that's what's important right now. So support them, support the arts, and yeah.
All right, so next up we have Michaela C. Moore. I gotta make sure. Again, it's the multiple names thing.
I know, you gotta like separate it a little bit in the middle there.
How are you doing?
I'm great. I mean, just, what is it they, everybody says, living the dream, whatever that is right now.
There was a guy, so at SCAD, there's this guy that always comes to orientation, and he has this book called Living the Dream. I'm pretty sure it's in my book cabinet right now. I'm sure I'll find it later, and I'll show it to you. I'll send you a picture of it.
Amazing.
This guy's just like this big motivational speaker, and he's like, oh, you gotta live the dream, gotta live the dream. So everyone at SCAD knows the phrase, living the dream.
Living the dream. That's always the thing. It's like somebody, the waiter asks you at the restaurant, how are you doing today? Ah, living the dream, so. That's me.
Oh my gosh. So what have you been up to since Rocky's been done?
Oh, goodness. Well, actually, a lot. All of it to do with theater, I would say. Right around the time that we did Rocky, which I had so much fun doing. I've never gotten to do a virtual musical before, and I got to do it with Wylie, Gavin, and everything. I have to... all the double names, as you said. But it was so much fun because I didn't really know what to expect out of it. And the thing that we put together, I was so entertained, and I'm like, I'm in this, but I'm having so much fun just watching it, and I already did it, so I don't have to freak out about being on stage right now and like, am I gonna trip or fall or something? So that was super cool. But about that time, right after we filmed it, I got hired full-time to the temp position that I've been doing since July. So I just work in insurance. If you ever need like small business insurance, I got you. I know way too much about it. And I'm still doing that. It's one of those that it's, I guess it's like a really cool imposter syndrome kind of thing that I've worked through the ranks that now I'm like almost a senior member at this company and I'm a mentor and everything. And it's absolutely insane because I'm like, haha, I'm an actor. What? But yeah, and other than that, I've been trying to develop new skills and working on possibly getting some representation out of, that's what we're doing during a pandemic too. And I'm just like getting to chat with people. If you're an agent and you're watching this, like, what's up? Hey.
Yeah, yeah, sign Michaela right now.
I got you. No, but I've also, a cool thing about Rocky Horror too is that I had at the beginning of the pandemic, I bought all of this really amazing recording equipment and my Focusrite and everything, and I had no idea how to use it. But even just doing our production taught me a lot about editing myself and everything. And so I'm trying to delve a little bit more into things like voiceover that I've never gotten to do before.
I think being able to, something like what Gavin was saying before was just like, we're in this mode of already self-taping and learning that, you know, we can do all this stuff by ourselves at home, learning how to use our camera, learning how to use our microphones. And that's so awesome that you're able to have this new talent now of voiceover acting. That's awesome.
Well, I kind of make a joke a lot. I live in Hell's Kitchen, and I moved back. It was kind of a really interesting situation that when we started this whole crazy world last March, it coincided with a lot of weird things happening in my life. I had booked a show, and the show coincided with when my lease was up at my old apartment. And that was the end of March. So I went, okay, I'll put my stuff in storage, do the show, come back and have a new place. It ended up being that I had put my stuff in storage and I didn't come back for a while. But it coincided right there, and the show that I was in got canceled. Everything crazy like that. But I didn't have to pay rent at the time, and I really lucked out right at the dot there. But now that I've come back and I've gotten to revamp kind of a work from home environment at my new place, I really make the joke a lot that this is a home recording studio that I happen to sleep in.
I like that a lot. That's funny.
I've adapted so many weird things. Like, the walls are padded with different materials and pictures and stuff, so it's kind of a sound environment. I have, I just bought actually a suspension microphone holder, so I can just pull it down from the wall whenever I want to record. I have, and I use this for Rocky Horror too, I have a curtain rod that I screwed in above my closet that drops down to a self-tape curtain. I mean, it's really bad, but that's what it is here now.
Are you still doing the podcast that you started?
I am, yeah. So that's another big thing that I did during the pandemic, just varying, why don't I do this? And I mentioned earlier that I got this really cool recording equipment. So I do a podcast with my friend Keith, and we're planning our second season here. We took a little hiatus because Keith got a job that worked overnights at a COVID testing site. He also got COVID at one point, so it was a wild journey for us. But it's called We're Only Children. And if you've ever listened to podcasts along the strain of, one of my favorites is My Brother and Me, where it's these three brothers answering Yahoo questions, and it's just a ridiculous comedy podcast. That's exactly the vein that we're in. And I guess if you really want to know my weird side, definitely check out the podcast. We have everything under the sun. It turned into a conspiracy theory where we were trying to defeat Elvis Presley, who has really been alive this entire time. He's just been in hiding. And we were going to do that with an army of only children, because I'm an only child and Keith is an only child, and we were very against siblings. But it's a fun podcast. It's hard to describe just off the jump, but trust me, you should listen to it.
I listened to a couple of the episodes while we were doing Rocky, because I saw you posting about it. I will say it is a very, very entertaining listen. if you're crocheting, or if you're just sitting and, you know, you got nothing to do, seriously, just put it on. It is so fun. I think the episodes are only like, what, like 45 minutes long or something?
Yeah, about 40, 45 minutes. And I definitely, that's what I tell everybody. It's a great background podcast, because it's one of those that you'll go, oh, this is nice just listening to them. What did they just say?
Yeah.
And that's how it kind of goes. So I tell people too, I'll compliment him. Keith, my friend in that, is one of the funniest people I've ever met in my life. We met doing musical theater, doing Shrek the Musical, where I cannot explain to you why, but I played the dragon. So,
because your voice is ridiculously good. That's why you played the dragon.
It, a small person with a dragon voice.
All right, Michaela, what do you have for us tonight?
Well, actually, I drew back on a song that I haven't done in a long time. Speaking of, I guess, small person with dragon voice or something. I used to do, and I'm pulling it up on my computer now. I'm from Mississippi. I'm from Biloxi, Mississippi. You've seen a lot of Mississippi on this episode tonight.
Yes, Gavin is also from Mississippi. Just...
And for 4 years when I was in college, I did the Miss Mississippi pageant. The only way you can tell is because my hair is big. I don't know.
Is that the tell for Miss Mississippi?
It was a very interesting time in my life, and I tell people that, and if they're friends with me and know how dorky and weird I am now, they're just like, okay. But so actually, what I'm going to sing tonight was my talent song when I did the pageants. And if you look it up on YouTube, it's horrifying. You're like, this can't be the same person. But it was, they just keep moving the line from Smash. So I thought we'd have some fun with that tonight.
Oh, very nice. Yes. Let's hear it.
All right. The field was bright with clover. I saw the finish sign. I started as a rover, and then victory was mine. I thought the race was over, but they just keep moving the line. They cheered at my persistence, but prayed for my decline. The path of least resistance led to Hollywood and Vine. I tried to go the distance, but they just keep moving the line. I jumped all of the hurdles to break out of the pack. I started on the outside and then hit the inside track. I left the other fillies back at the starting gate. Was ready on my mark. I got to set to hurry up and wait. So talent and ambition won me a chance to shine. I aced the big audition, but it's raining on cloud nine. Can't beat the competition, cause they just keep moving the line. I handled every corner, each bump along the track, and when I saw the riven well, there was no turning back. I won the photo finish, I posed for all the men, but before I got my trophy, well, the race began again. So I made friends with rejection, I've straightened up my spine. I'll change each imperfection till it's time to drink the wine. I toast to resurrection, but they just keep moving the line. Please give me some direction, cause they just keep moving the line.
Boom! That is how you sing a song.
That is definitely how I always am, because it's just like, belt, and then...
Yeah, you have to. You have to. I was watching this Seth Rudetsky, what is the name of his show that he does?
I know, it's just like that Saturdays with Seth kind of thing, whatever. Oh, Stars in the House.
No. It's like Seth Rudetsky, like, deconstructs or something. I don't remember.
Oh, I think I know what you're talking about. He's got so many crazy things.
He has so many different series. But he talks about this one where Patti LuPone is singing Blow Gabriel Blow. And he says that Patti's thing that she does is when she enters or exits stage, she's got to belt the big high note to be like, I'm exiting, I'm coming back. It's so funny because she does that all the time. So
that
I think
exactly how I feel. I have the arm that takes me across the stage.
Here we go. I'm ending the song.
And here we go.
Oh my God.
That's always it.
Michaela, you are so wonderful. Thank you so much for talking to me tonight.
Well, thank you for having me. And yeah, definitely to everybody else, definitely keep up with Tenacious Theatrics. I'm so grateful that I was able to have this opportunity to meet you and everyone else during this process and to really just have this wonderful artistic fulfillment in a really trying time.
Yeah, I mean, you're wonderful, so why not? Awesome. Thank you so much, Michaela.
Thank you.
All right, we have one final guest with us tonight. This is someone who I have not worked with yet, but I'm very, very excited to get to know more and very excited to share with you tonight with all of our viewers. This is Molly Burris. Hello, Molly.
Hello. Thank you for having me.
So tell me and our audience just a little bit about yourself, where you're from, what your background is, how you got into this ridiculously crazy industry.
Definitely. Yeah, so I was born and raised in Texas. I was raised just north of Austin, Texas, in a town called Round Rock. And I was a singer first. I started singing at a very, very young age. And found theater in like middle school. But all throughout high school, I was planning on being a vocal performance major until about my junior year. And then I was like, okay, I think I want to study musical theater. But then my senior year of high school, I got a college audition coach. And she told me that because I couldn't do a double pirouette at the age of 18 or whatever, that I shouldn't major in musical theater. Which is just wild. But so I only auditioned for acting programs going into college because I was like, okay, this is what my coach told me to do, even though I'd been singing for so long. And so I ended up going to Webster University in St. Louis, Missouri, which was like my top choice school, school that I'd wanted to go to since I was a freshman. And I came in as an acting major. And then about halfway through the program, I was like, I think I still really want to be a musical theater major. And so I switched majors halfway through school, which meant that I had to play a big game of catch up the whole time that I was finishing out my degree. But I really think that everything happens for a reason. So I wouldn't change my trajectory, but yeah, that's how I got into everything.
That's so crazy that like I know like the whole like stereotype is, oh, you want to be a musical theater performer, you have to dance, you have to sing, you have to act, right? The whole triple threat, right? And it's great for people who are.
Definitely.
I myself am not. I don't consider myself a dancer at all.
Me neither.
The people who have seen me perform say, you're a dancer. Mackenzie says, I'm a dancer. Our choreographer and production manager says, I'm a dancer. I did this production of You're in Town back in 2019, where I think I did like the most dancing I've ever done in my entire life. Our choreographer's name was Meredith Theron. And she kicked my beep because again, like, I'm not a dancer. I can follow strict choreography is what I tell people. Mm-hmm. I know how to do moves, but I am not well versed in it. So it's kind of a bummer to hear that, you know, your college coach was like, you can't do this.
Where's
I think it might have been better to say
movers?
It will be more challenging or like you won't get certain roles because of that, but to just flat out say no. But I'm glad that, you know, your journey ended you where you are now, because, you know, now we're here. It's so wonderful. So kind of tell me about your COVID pandemic shutdown. What has that done to your life and your career?
Yeah, so I was in New York City the week of March 10th doing my senior showcase for Webster University.
Oh my God.
So I, like, are half the agents didn't even come, and I don't blame them. I got COVID on that trip, like from the like first epicenter, like it was so bad. And so I flew from New York on March 12th to Austin, Texas, because my brother was getting married. But I was terrified the whole time, because in Texas they didn't know yet about how bad it was. Like it hadn't really hit there, but I was just there. Like I literally just gotten the call that like Broadway had shut down, and I was just trying to get an agent or an audition or something. And of course everything just got canceled. All my friends who had like Hamilton callbacks got canceled. And my whole class was just kind of scattered. But so I went to my brother's wedding, and I was just terrified. I was like, oh my gosh, I'm gonna kill my whole family. Luckily, everyone was fine. I got back to St. Louis, and my boyfriend and I both had COVID. I gave it to him because of the sicky theater kids in New York. But so I was offered a year-long contract in February of last year. That was supposed to start right after I graduated college. It has been postponed, but fingers crossed, we just got word that July is looking like when it's gonna start, which makes me very, very happy, because I would love to do my post-grad job at some point.
Yeah, so what are you allowed to say what the contract is?
Or? Sorry. I'm working with Charleston Stage Company in their resident acting company. So I'm going to be in about 6 of their shows over the next year, hopefully, if it all goes to plan.
So your work ethic is, I love it. You know, I haven't worked with you personally, but you did audition for Little Shop Online Cabaret. And the conversations that we had during your interview process was very like, wow, this girl knows what she's talking about. She's done her research. She is a trained actor. And that's one of the reasons why I called you in for this interview tonight, was because you had just an amazing work ethic. How do you think that has helped you with, since COVID shut down, how has that helped you with projects that you've worked on since COVID started?
Well, first of all, thank you for your kind words. That's so kind, so sweet. But yeah, basically, you know, when COVID first hit and my entire career trajectory just kind of went down the toilet, I gave myself a couple of months where I was just like, I'm not even gonna think about this. I'm not even gonna look at auditions. I'm not gonna do anything, which, I mean, there was nothing happening for that period of time also. But when I finally felt like I was like healed again, the mentality that I've been working like through and for is find the love in auditioning, which I've never had before, because auditions are like the scariest part. But the reality of it is like the audition is the work. The audition is like, is actually the job that we actors have, is auditioning. And like getting into things is great and also what pays us, so is also the job, definitely. But like the audition is the work. And so I've started really trying to make sure that every audition I go into, I'm having as much fun as I can. And it's actually been really helpful with self-tapes to be able to kind of send something into the void and then not really think about if anything comes of it. Because I'm definitely a worrier, and it's really nice to just be like, if they see it, they'll see it. If they don't, whatever. I had fun. And it's made like getting rejected a lot easier also. And so, yeah, it's been really fun to be able to kind of take this work that, you know, I spent the past 4 years doing kind of mind-numbingly and be like, oh yeah, this is why I like doing this. This is why I had fun. This is why I chose to do this with my life. So yeah, I guess I'm excited to put the work into the auditions for the first time ever, because we have the time to.
Right. And again, that's something I really, really appreciated when you auditioned for us. I really wish you were singing something tonight, because you have such a beautiful voice.
Okay, I mean, like maybe I can pull something up if you just want me to do something.
Oh, well, so do you have a website or an Instagram?
Yes, okay, so then I'll talk about the thing first, and I'll just promote my website, and I have reels and clips and everything.
There you go.
So yeah. That'll be the way we'll do it.
You just have this incredible voice, and
thank you.
I want people to hear it. So yes, tell me about the thing that you were promoting tonight.
Yes, so in July of last year, my classmates and I got very frustrated because of our institution, because we've been having conversations the entire time we were there about the lack of diversity and the lack of inclusion that happens in most programs across the country, but we care about ours specifically. And so we're having all these discussions, and then we thought, okay, it's great to talk about things and be like, there's problems here, but what can we actually do? Like, what can we change? And so a couple of my classmates and I got together and we decided to start an organization called Ghostlight Audition Group. And I'm gonna kind of butcher the mission statement right now, but the Ghostlight Audition Group's mission is to create accessibility and diversity for all seeking to change the world of performing arts through higher education, with a specific focus in BIPOC, LGBTQ+ people, people with different disabilities and abilities, and then people from different financial backgrounds, because we do recognize that there is a serious like class structure of who can attend certain programs and stuff like that. And so what we aim to do is provide a resource for students who may not have the means to, or may not have the coach or even a theater teacher that will back them up, or even support at home, to get all of the information that they need to audition for theater programs across the country, both in performance as well as in design, tech, and stage management. So we are currently an online resource. We have a web handle. I'll send it to Leonard. He'll link it.
But it's it will be right here.
It'll be right here.
Right there.
www.ghostlightauditiongroup.org. And on it, we have lists of repertoire. So we have pages and pages of songs and monologues that are age appropriate. And we have specific categories for BIPOC and LGBTQ+ people. And we have a page about building your portfolio if you're interested in design, tech, and stage management. We have links to, what's the difference between a BA and a BFA, and what do you need for different degrees within design, tech, and stage management. We have a YouTube channel where people have graciously volunteered their knowledge to film videos for us to also help students who are seeking audition help. So we have ones about like, here's a dance warm-up that you can do before any dance call you have, and here's how to talk to a pianist in an audition room, and here's how to break down a contemporary monologue. And then we also have just, you know, an Instagram, a Twitter, and a Facebook where we promote stuff and whatnot. We have other goals that we would like to accomplish in the future. So if you do check out Ghostlight Audition Group and you feel so inclined to donate, there's a big donate button at the top, and it's through PayPal, so it's very secure and very safe. That's what my main artistic drive and creation has been within the past year, has been creating and promoting this resource to try and help make the world on the stage reflects the world that we live in, because it doesn't, and it should.
That is such a wonderful thing. I'm sitting here, like, going through the whole process. Like, even when I was, you know, auditioning for colleges and stuff, I had no idea what I was doing. I went to high school in Hong Kong, so I didn't get, like, the vigorous, like, you have to go to a theater high school, you need to, you know, do all these things, you have to get a book together. I didn't know any of that stuff until I got to college, which was very unfortunate, because I feel like, you know, SCAD has a great program, but I wish I had known to do all these other things to prep.
Well, and that's the main thing that we have such a big problem with, is that the information is out there, but it's not free. And so we pride ourselves in being a completely free resource. None of it is paid. And then you hear people who are like, oh, I auditioned for 24 programs. And it's like, how did you even do that? We're trying to kind of end the stigma of like, oh, you didn't know this, so you didn't know how to get into this school. It's like, okay, let's make this information free and accessible and easy to read, so that anyone can come and pursue a career in theater, because it should be for everyone.
What is your target audience for this?
Yeah, so I mean, we aim it somewhat at high school kids, but also because anyone can go to college at any point in time that they want. We definitely don't like dumb down things, and we have pieces for people of all age ranges. But yeah, we're just, the main focus is for anybody who is interested in going to college for theater.
Yeah, that's absolutely wonderful.
Thank you.
That makes my heart happy, that there are people like you, that, and the rest of your team that think about these things.
Thank you so much. And I cannot speak high enough about Tenacious. I have not worked with y'all yet, but every single interaction that I've had has been so lovely. And yeah, even just explaining to my mom, I was like, oh yeah, like, I didn't get cast with these people, but they still reached out to me and want to do something with me. And she was like, that's amazing. I was like, I know, good people.
Well, that's certainly going to change. We will work with you in some capacity because you are just absolutely amazing. Awesome. Well, Molly, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us tonight. And again, we will make sure to plaster.
Ghostlight Audition Group.
Ghostlight Audition Group. We will make sure to plaster that everywhere. And if you want, we could even talk about putting it up on our website, because I would love to have just a direct link to that. That would be absolutely amazing.
It would be really amazing. Thank you.
Well, I think that is it for tonight. Again, we have just wonderful, wonderful talent joining us tonight. And again, if you have some projects that you'd like to share with us or a website that you'd like to promote with us, just get in contact with us at tenacioustheatrics@gmail.com, or you could submit a form on our website, tenacioustheatrics.com. And again, be sure to check out more episodes of How We Keep the Art Alive. And don't forget to watch Little Shop of Horrors Online Cabaret once it premieres in May. We will see you on the next episode.